there was a point about that, the last song that I wanted to make, that ties right into what Kevin was saying about hocketing. There's a section in there where they go, and all the different instruments are taking individual pieces of that phrase and doing it around robin. So
that's actually one of my favorite parts of the track. I definitely made a note of that. Before I offer mine, you know, what are your thoughts on Odyssey and the Dixie Dregs, Kevin?
Well, first of all, I'm so thrilled that Mike chose that particular track of the Dixie Dregs, because this is the God's honest truth. That's my favorite Dixie Dregs track. I love that piece of music. It has influenced me big time over the years. I've done pieces of music of my own that were borrowing some things from that. I just love that track. And like you said, the title is perfect. That's one of the cool things about Dixie Dregs is, if I'm being honest, and we're talking about prog rock, and most prog rock is vocal, but I do prefer instrumental music probably more than anything else personally. So that's one thing about the Dixie Dregs, was they were an instrumental group up until the very end. They got pressurized to try to bring in a singer and commercialize their sound, all that stuff. I just love it. And you were talking about their Mahavishnu Orchestra influence, which is why some people consider them a jazz rock band or a fusion band. And I think you're probably right. They're really more of a kind of a instrumental progressive band, maybe kind of in the similar way of a band like Focus in the early 70s. But the Mahavishnu Orchestra influence was huge on them. There's no doubt about that. In fact, do you might remember a magazine? I think it was called Hit Parader.
Yeah.
They used to have these top 10 desert island disc things, and they'd get musicians to write out, if you're on a desert island, you can only have 10. I saw one where they included Steve Morse and bassist Andy West. And Steve Morse's top pick was Birds of Fire, and Andy West was the Inner Mounting Flame. Between the two of them, they chose the first two Mahavishnu albums. You know, so that influence of Mahavishnu and this sort of jazz rock thing was definitely huge. But as you said, Mahavishnu really was kind of right on the border between jazz rock and progressive rock in a way. But yeah, Dixie Dregs, phenomenal musicians. Steve Morse wrote almost everything. Andy West had at least one composition I know on What If. And he was astonishing. I mean, the virtuosity, I mean, it's right up the prog thing there, the complexity, the constantly shifting time signatures, the complexity of the music, the incredible variety of styles on one album. We go from a pure classical piece to a long prog epic to a more jazz feeling thing. Amazing band out there. For you listeners, if you have not heard the Dixie Dregs, check them out.
Yeah, well said. You know, that particular track, Odyssey, touches a lot of bases. Parts are very mellow, other parts really rock. There are a lot of tempo changes, you know, but somehow it all remains cohesive, probably because, as Mike said, it was composed. And it wasn't really a jam. It maybe grew out of a jam, but it was composed. And now we've learned this new word, hocketing. As I said, I've heard that technique used before. I didn't know there was a term for it, so I'm being educated. Industry Standard, which was a 1982 Dixie Dregs album, was the one of theirs that I first heard. And, you know, there were a couple tracks with singing. I think they had Patrick Simmons from the Doobie Brothers. And as Kevin mentioned, the label said, hey, you guys are really great. Why don't you try and have a hit? And they're like, eh. Actually, Andy West lives here in the Phoenix area. Oh, cool. And I'm Facebook friends with him. And, yeah, I should get him on the show. Oh, obvious. I saw Steve Morse do a clinic in a Sacramento music store in the 80s, probably 82, 83, probably around the time of Industry Standard. He's just got his guitar out, played a little bit, and asked if anybody had any questions. And, you know, the interesting thing about his style is he tends to pick every single note. He doesn't really do a lot of pull-offs and hammer-ons. It's like if there's five notes, he's going to pick five times. I felt a little embarrassed because I had to slip out early because I had my Les Paul and I think I had a Hamer. They're in the car. It was a really hot day in Sacramento. I was really worried about my guitar is baking out there. So I was kind of like the first person to leave. And you know, Steve Morse looked over at me like, oh, is that guy leaving? You know, I was so self-conscious about that. But, yeah, you know, great band, great players. And for a brief time, Steve Morse was in Kansas, you know, and after hearing that track, you know, there's a little bit of cross-pollination. It makes sense, which makes a beautiful segue into our next track from Kevin, which is, in fact, by Kansas. So we have a second shot of Americans. Want to warn everybody, this is our second and final shot of Americans. So what have you got for us next, Kevin, from that mighty Kansas band?
Kansas is a band that is strictly perfectly representative of progressive rock from the American side of things. There are some prog snobs out there that don't like to consider Kansas progressive rock, and I'd say, well, they haven't heard their first five albums then at all. The principal composer, who was also a keyboardist and a guitarist, was Kerry Livgren. And he was and still is really, really classically influenced. He had a grandmother or somebody that partially helped raise him, and she used to play him classical music when he was growing up. And he got into rock and all the bands of the 60s, and then he got into actually, funny enough, one of his favorite bands, according to him in his own autobiography, was Gentle Giant. So you can see some of that influence. But their stuff, he had extremely complex literate lyrics to his music, which is a big part of what he did. But the music itself is just very symphonic. You know, they had Robbie Williams on violin, but they also had him on keyboards at times, and then Steve Walsh also on keyboards. They could have two guitars. I mean, it was really well orchestrated music, very broad in the orchestrations and the complexity all the earmarks of classic progressive rock, but from an American point of view. This particular track is called Magnum Opus, which closes their fourth album, Left Overture, 76, and it's almost completely instrumental, something they rarely did. Something I wish they did more of was instrumentals, but has some vocals at the beginning. And when you listen to this track, you get the feeling, and this is not an insult in any way, that they basically took every single leftover riff that they had amongst them, because it's a group composition, and they found a way to cohesively put it into this absolute epic, which Magnum Opus is a perfect title for this particular track. It's astonishing, and take a listen.
Yeah, this was definitely a band I paid attention to back in the day, back in their prime. So we'll have more to say about it in a minute, but first, from their classic 1976 album, it's Kansas. Let's dig some Magnum Opus.
Thank you.
Mike, Kansas, your thoughts?
Yeah, Kansas gets a bad deal a lot of times. I mean, I think because they had hits, you know, they had Dust in the Wind and stuff like that. But clearly, as the last track shows, they're really talented composers and performers. And like you said, you know, my track with the Dixie Dregs, Steve Morse ended up playing in that band, and they really had, they really embodied the American spirit of progressive rock, you know. So it was kind of a no-brainer. I think the Dixie Dregs sounded a lot like Kansas with no vocals in a lot of cases. So.
I would agree with that.
Good point.
I was a very big fan of Song for America as well, and Cheyenne Anthem was one of my favorites, so I'll throw that in there.
Oh, yeah, I would definitely agree with that. You know, this strikes me as a sort of show-off track. It's kind of like, you know, hey, we can give you Dust in the Wind and Carry On Wayward Son, but if we want to, we can also prog with the best of them. I don't get the leftover aspect of it. I'll listen to it with fresh ears because Kevin said that, but I got the sense they're going, look, you know, it's towards the end of the album. Let's really go for something. Because as with Dregs, these guys were heavily influenced by the prog scene in the UK, clearly. But on the other hand, you know, Cheyenne Anthem's a great example. They're singing about Native Americans. They're singing about American topics. Carrie Livgren, big-time Christian, a lot of Christian topics and things that weren't being done the same way. So they have their own thing. Definitely rocked out guitars. The guitars are rocking harder than you're probably going to hear in the English bands. But, you know, Song for America comes to mind. Left Overture, Point of No Return, classic stuff. I actually saw Kansas at the Cow Palace on their Audio Visions tour. So, you know, it was an album or two after that stuff, but the bulk of the show was still made up of Point of No Return tracks, you know, Left Overture tracks, Song for America. I don't know if they did Lamplight Symphony or not, but stuff like that. And, you know, it was a great time. But Carrie Livgren, great writer. Steve Walsh, great singer. So I'm glad Kansas was included because I always think of them when I think of prog rock. You know, I think of a handful of American bands and mostly English. But as I said at the outset, always exceptions. There might be some band in Mongolia that's the greatest prog rock band that we've never heard. And they have this one obscure album from 1976. But speaking of the 70s, you know, I'd mentioned that everything we're going to hear was from the 70s with one exception, which we're going to hear now. This is Mike's pick dating back to 1983. I'll let Mike tell us about it.
Ah, yes. Well, you said UK in your last statement. Oddly enough, this guy's from the band UK. I actually formed the band UK, Eddie Jobson. But he goes back a little further than that. He's actually started out at 16 in a band called Curved Air, which is another progressive rock band in England. And then he graduated to Roxy Music for a while, and then who actually just got inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame a couple weeks ago. And he was there for that. And then he was in Frank Zappa. And he was on the Live in New York album. And then he formed UK with Bill Bruford, Alan Holdsworth, and John Wetton from King Crimson. And that was a very significant prog band. If not, they weren't around for very long, but they made a mark, if not for what they did, but for what their members did afterwards. So Eddie's another one of these guys like Keith Emerson, who was classically trained. He played piano and violin, and really, you know, embraced synthesizers heavily. And this is the track we're going to hear is from 1983. This is post all those bands, post UK. He's actually entering into the MTV era, trying to get the MTV generation to do a prog mind meld with him. You know, like there's a video for this, for a couple of the songs on this album, which is called the Zinc, the Green Album by Zinc was the name of the project. But the song is called Hear My Friends, and it features a lot of different changes, a lot of his piano playing, a lot of his violin playing. And also I might mention that one of the hallmarks of prog is that a lot of the, like this album in itself has a lot of recurring themes, musical themes within the album that you'll hear in different songs at different contexts. So that's a concept album in itself.
Well, I wish I would have known about the video beforehand. I would have checked that out, because I do have a question about that title, Who My Friends? Because there's a couple ways to take it. If, like a question, like who are my friends is one way to take it. Or, you know, maybe he's telling us he knows Roger Daltrey and Pete Townsend and the Who are his friends.
It has a question mark after the end, so.
Okay. The version I saw didn't, but that makes sense. Well, let's check this out. From the Green album, here's Eddie Jobson and Zinc with a track called Who My Friends. We'll be right back. So, Kevin, what did you think of that track?
I thought it was great. Eddie Jobson is just incredible. Yeah, that track sounded great, and it was so distinctive of his style with both the keyboards, the violin playing, the composition especially. It reminded me, in a few parts, it reminded me a little bit of the closing track of the second and final UK studio album, a track called Carrying No Cross. That's just astonishing. It's kind of in the magnum opus vein of just going all over the place. It reminded me of just a little bit of that there came to mind because it's such a distinctive Eddie Jobson thing. But yeah, it sounded great. And it was not one that I had heard. So I was glad that Mike introduced that to me because I was not aware of that band or that music. I got lost in the 80s. I did not like the 80s. So even the bands and artists that I liked, I kind of lost track with them, to be honest with you. So it was good to know that Eddie was still getting it done, I'll tell you.
So we need to go get that hot tub time machine, go back to 1970 and relive all the way to 79. well, you know, whenever I hear the name Eddie Jobson, my mind goes to UK with Alan Holdsworth, John Wetton, and Bill Bruford. You know, he's one of those guys known as a multi-talent. You know, as that track demonstrated, he's a writer, he's a vocalist. Obviously, he's a great keyboard player. Obviously, he's a great violinist. You know, that track is definitely heavy on the synths, which is fine. You know, there are elements in there that remind me of other prog bands, but once again, it's a unique mixture. You know, what struck me when I first heard that is kind of sounded to me like what it might have sounded like if Jean-Luc Ponty had played on Yes's Drama album.
Interesting mix, yeah.
I wasn't familiar with the track until Mike suggested it, and I can tell it's one of those recordings where certain little parts and riffs seem they're going to embed themselves in your brain. And you'll find yourself hearing it in your head later at an unexpected time going, what is that from? And then you hear it as the Eddie Jobson thing. Yeah, so great. So I'm glad that you went with a little bit more obscure one and went with the Zinc track instead of something by UK. So that was great. Kevin's next choice, another big name in prog rock, possibly one of the biggest, King Crimson. Now, what have you got for us from them, Kevin?
I talked earlier about the influence of jazz and classical combining together with rock to create some of that early English progressive rock in the late 60s, early 70s. King Crimson just personified that so well. And this track is in the same way we talked about Bourrée from Jethro Tull. They took a Bach piece, they put a jazz swinging rhythm underneath it. This piece is maybe my all-time favorite Robert Fripp composition. The guitarist and main composer for a lot of the King Crimson stuff, at least in this era of them, from their third album in 1970 called Lizard. It's part of a suite, actually, a sidelong suite. It's basically a bolero rhythm influenced by Ravel's bolero, Maurice Ravel, the classical composer. But in the middle, it goes into this full-on traditional jazz soloing jam with trumpet and trombone and saxophone all playing over each other. But bookending that is this beautiful, absolutely heart-wrenchingly beautiful oboe theme that Robert Fripp composed that comes in the early part, then it goes into this jazz section over the bolero rhythm that continues to play, and then it goes back into that that beautiful oboe melody again, and it's just an astonishing instrumental piece of music that brings all of those elements together. For some people, maybe it's not the most representative of King Crimson, but for me, I think it's just certainly an excellent representation of progressive rock in the early 70s.
Yeah, that's a great choice, and I want to point out, you know, it's subtitled as The Peacock's Tail, and that's T-A-L-E, not T-A-I-L.
Yeah.
Because peacocks do have tails, and boy, do they. I mean, that's what they're known for. Well, great. Well, let's check this out from their 1970 Lizard album. It's King Crimson with Bolero, The Peacock's Tail. Well, I have to say, you know, we're talking about prog rock. I definitely hear the prog in that track more than I hear the rock. There are a lot of jazzy moments, classical orchestral moments. I don't think the drummer played anything other than snare drum throughout the whole thing.
The whole thing, just a bolero rhythm, just like Ravel's piece,
And it's certainly a very beautiful piece of music. I know King Crimson has done many other things that are completely different from this. What do you think of that track, and what are your impressions of King Crimson, Mike?
Well, in 2017, Crimson's still touring. They just celebrated their 50th anniversary. And, I had heard some of the early catalog, from Court of the Crimson King and whatnot. But really, the 70s were a big hole for me as far as Crimson was. And I got back on the boat in like 80, 81 when they regrouped with Adrian Belew and Bill Bruford and Tony Levin and became a diehard fan. But, you know, this period was still a mystery for me until I went to see the 2017 tour where they have an eight-piece band now. And you know, one thing I'll say is going back and listening to a lot of these progressive rock tunes, you're at the mercy of the technology and the production values of the time a lot of times, you know. So that affects some listeners more than it affects others. Some people can deal. Like if you listen to the original Mahavishnu orchestra recordings, it's just raw, in your face. It's hard. It's not very pretty, but the music is astonishing. And a lot of the same for like King Crimson recordings. It's, you know, you listen with today's ears and it sounds hard in some ways, you know, it sounds dated. But when I saw King Crimson on their tour a couple of years ago, they reproduced the 70s stuff, which had never been done with the 80s bands, like with the Belew lineup and all that. They reproduced the 70s stuff, and it was absolutely astonishing. They played Fracture, and they played all kinds of stuff from, you know, that time period. So while I'm not a great authority on this time period, I will say that this song and a lot of songs that they played were just phenomenal and really gave me a new appreciation to want to dive in to that stuff heavier, you know.
Well, I know King Crimson is one of those bands that has had so many people come and go that they need a timeline in Wikipedia to represent all the different iterations. I know Robert Fripp has been in every version of the band, which makes sense. And like Mike, I also first heard them in the Adrian Belew, Bill Bruford, Tony Levin era, the Discipline era. I'd heard the name before, just like Gentle Giant. And then, you know, here's the Chapman Stick and Tony Levin. I think I saw them on the show Fridays playing Elephant Talk.
I saw that one too.
Yeah, pretty cool. You know, like Gentle Giant, it's another band I really need to go back and dig into a little bit more. I mean, I heard the Court of the Crimson King and this and that and here and there, but to really go start to finish on it is something I really want to do because, you know, there's so many players that I know that have been in there. I mean, Greg Lake was in there. Boz Burrell from Bad Company was in there. Tony Levin was in there. So I'm going to add that to my musical to-do list. Well, we have one more track to play, and if anybody out there is thinking, how could we have done this show about prog rock without playing anything by this few particular acts who are acknowledged as the top practitioners of the form? Well, remember, we said this was part one of our discussion. There's a lot more yet to come. In the meantime, I want to remind everybody about Kevin's book, Back to Schoolin', What Led Zeppelin Taught Me About Music, and his podcast, Long Story Short, with Kevin Courtright. If you're on Facebook, you're going to want to check out Mike's group, Have You Heard?, which is an excellent resource for music that runs a little more to the obscure and lesser known. Some nice discoveries waiting for you there. And also look for Mike's articles at allaboutjazz.com. I had Mike and Kevin choose the majority of the music for this episode, but we're going to be closing it out with my own pick. In keeping with our theme of English bands from the 70s, I'm going to be taking us back to the Peter Gabriel era of Genesis. This is from their 1973 Selling England by the Pound album. And I have to say it's one of my favorite recordings of all time in any genre. Tony Banks, who's the main writer, really shines on this as a keyboard player. It also features a quintessential example of Steve Hackett's guitar style. There's a musical phrase sort of similar to Bolero we heard with King Crimson, you know, really memorable phrase that Peter Gabriel introduces on the flute, and then Steve Hackett restates it on the guitar. You know, most bands would have probably just gone with one or the other, not both. But this is what I like about prog rock. You know, we're going to do whatever we want and damn the running time. Peter Gabriel's lyrics give this track a very pastoral quality and also a thought-provoking quality. There are lines like, "And so with gods and men, the sheep remain inside their pen, though many times they've seen the way to leave. You know, the idea that one would prefer to be a willing prisoner when they have the option to escape. You know, it's an interesting idea that certainly carries over into the realm of human behavior, which makes tracks like this and this genre of music so interesting to me. So the name of the song is Firth of Fifth, and before I play it, let me get your thoughts on both this track specifically and also on the wide topic of Genesis generally. Who wants to go first?
Well, I'll go first because, to be honest with you, it's another one of those bands that has like a, you know, depending on when you tie into Genesis, they're a different band altogether. I didn't backtrack as far as I could with Genesis. When I was a kid, I didn't have an unlimited budget for records. So it was spotty at the moment, but I had to backtrack into a lot of artists. And Genesis, I only probably made it back into the early Peter, the late Peter Gabriel period. By that time, I was more into Peter Gabriel as an artist who, you know, he's another one of those guys that you could include here as a solo artist, but more for progressive influences than actual, you know, fitting into what everybody accepts as the genre of progressive rock. But I mean, you listen to some of his tracks like San Jacinto and the stuff off of the Security album. There's no denying that it's art rock, progressive rock, whatever you want to call it. It's just a lot more modern than what we think of as the classic period. But that said, Genesis, there's so much there. For me, you know, a lot of this stuff people grew up with, I did not. So I listened to this with fresh ears now, and it's just like so deep. I'm not even ready to comment on it. There's so much going on in their early stuff, and I really love it. And like I said, they were a different animal to what they turned into in the 80s, which is it's all good. I mean, you know, but just like a lot of other prog acts from the 70s, as you hit the 80s and they kind of morphed into more popular music, but still bringing some of those progressive influences to the table. But I love this. I love this track, and I really marvel at. I have a lot of diehard Genesis fans that love this track, so I love it.
Kevin?
Huge, huge Peter Gabriel era Genesis fan myself. Big, big time. I love them. One of my all-time favorite tracks is a sidelong epic called Supper's Ready that unfortunately won't be heard in these two episodes, but I recommend everybody check it out. This one may be my second favorite behind that one. I was really glad you chose it, Dan. It's a brilliant, brilliant composition. So I love Genesis. The Peter Gabriel era was just incredible. That lineup was phenomenal. There's a book that I want to recommend to the listeners also, if they can track it down. It's by an author named Edward Macon, M-A-C-A-N. It's called Rocking the Classics, subtitled English Progressive Rock and the Counterculture. And he highlights, amongst all the stuff he talks about progressive rock, he highlights four representative tracks, two of which are coming up in part two of this. But one of them happens to be this track, Firth of Fifth. And he has just a couple of things to say about that I thought might be good for the audience before you play it. One, he almost sees it as being, and maybe many of our listeners don't know this kind of terminology, but classical structure called sonata form. So there's like a piano overture in B flat, then it goes into what's called the exposition in the key of B, then there's a development section in E minor to B flat to E minor, then there's a recapitulation back to the B, key of B, and then it has a little coda in the key of E. So that classical structure in this piece is just phenomenal. He has this to say about it, real quick sentence. He says, Firth of Fifth is in many ways an almost archetypal progressive rock piece, offering masculine / feminine contrasts on a number of levels. And those are very quickly on the feminine side. It has acoustic sections, passages without rhythm section, slow rhythmic motion, lyrical melodies, and open textures. And on the masculine side, electronic sections, passages with rhythm section, fast rhythmic motion, thematic or motivic melodies, and then denser textures. So he sees this track by Genesis kind of encapsulating just about everything you want from progressive rock just perfectly.
Wow, that was great production. I appreciate you offering all that. And I agree with everything he just said because I'm so familiar with it. There was a period of time where I could play this on the keyboard start to finish.
Oh, man, that's amazing.
Well, we're going to wrap this one up. So thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Mike. Thanks, everybody, for listening. As promised, we'll be back soon with part two of our discussion of progressive rock. We hope to see you then. And in the meantime, let's dig into some vintage Genesis. So long, everybody.
Like a cancer growth is removed by skill. Let it be revealed. A waterfall is madrigal. An inland sea is sea. Songs urge the sailors on till lured by the siren's cry. The sands of time.